today I want to talk to you about how to think like Jesus. How to think like Jesus. Or I could have even called it, you know, are you out of your mind? I could have said that to you. Because it's our mind that's messing us up. I could have talked to about living by the mind of Christ. Or I could ask the question this morning, what are you thinking? Even right now, what are you thinking? You know, but in essence, I named it, it's how to think like Jesus. But it has to do with your thinking. Of course, we have taught numerous messages through the years, probably more on thinking than any other subject almost, about how to, if you're going to conquer and overcome, your thinking is at the heartbeat of it. And through the healing ministry and anything else, thinking, your whole life of walking in victory is wrapped up in your thinking and what you, how you think. So this morning, we're going to look at, well, how do I think like Jesus? How do I get past me? How do I get to be and move into what He's called me to be, and how do I do it? And so that's the essence of where we're going. Nearly 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Paul exhorted the Philippians, the Corinthians, and the Romans, all of them, to guard their minds from the ungodly philosophies and reasoning agendas of carnal men. So it's the same thing. It hasn't changed yet. And let's see what Philippians has to say about it. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. So the first thing to notice is that the mind of Christ is one that is one of humility and one of servanthood. Those two things are at the top of the list. Jesus never worried about his reputation. And when men praised him, it didn't faze him. When they slaughtered him and came against him, it still didn't faze him. It didn't ruin him. He was single-mindedly. He was devoted to what his Father had to say. And the Bible said that he didn't say anything other than what his Father said to him. That's an amazing statement in itself, the way we run off at the mouth. Hello, church. Therefore, the thoughts of his mind were always redemptive thoughts. So when men said it was impossible, his mind would say it is possible. And when men said it was hopeless, his mind would say hope does not disappoint. There's always hope. It's always there. When men said it was foolish, his mind would say, what you call foolish, my Father calls wisdom. He saw things so totally different than you and I see. He confessed and declared that he came to earth to do exactly what, not his will, but the will of his Father. And he openly stated, as I said earlier, he went on to say, and this is kind of hard for me to comprehend at times, that what he never spoke anything at his own initiative. But what he heard from his Father is what he spoke. Never spoke anything. Wow. And as long as you and I entertain illusions of grandeur or seek after the praise of men or consider ourselves more highly than we should, we will not ever, ever walk in the mind of Christ. So humility is the essential foundation for thinking like Jesus thinks. Without him, we can do nothing. Apart from his mind and thoughts, our thoughts are blown apart by any wind of confusion or distraction. The good news is that, and I love this, your spirit can take you where your head cannot go. Whoa! Don't you love it? That's a quote. Your spirit can take you where your head cannot go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, your mind is not the essence of who you are. Your spirit is. Your mind was given to you by God like a canvas on which the Holy Spirit wants to paint pictures that help you become like Jesus. That's what your mind is like. Your mind is the receptacle for understanding and applying what rises up from the indwelling spirit. It's not about advocating or turning down or walking away from your mind, but it's about learning to ask the Lord what He thinks about what is on your mind at any given moment. You thought I was going to say ask Him what is on His mind. No, I said ask Him what He thinks about what you're thinking about. We so easily go through our natural mind. We draw our own conclusions, and then we run off in our own understanding without even ever asking the Lord, what do you think about that, Jesus? Am I hooked up with you at all? Am I thinking the way you would think? Am I seeing this with your eyes at all, Jesus? Or is this just learned behavior I have? We're in a different season, church. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So renewing your mind is a process. Renew literally means make new again. So though our minds may need to be renewed, do you understand that right now your spirit, grab it, your spirit is absolutely awesome. The Lord of glory has taken up residence inside of you and is head of household over you. He knows exactly what issues you face, what questions you have, what needs concern you, what wisdom you need to be an accurate representative of Him on this earth. He wants you to represent Him. So somebody who sees you will see Him. Now, this is an amazing statement. Because the Lord dwells in your spirit, you have within you everything that Jesus is. Now, right now. Amen. Everything that Jesus is, everything. We're so quick to know things and not know them. And yet, the scripture or Him living in us, it has not really hit us. We don't really know what it means. We've not learned in any kind of fashion. Okay, so we carry Him around, and look at the places we carry Him. Oh, dear Jesus. We carry Him around. You and I don't have to think about Jesus being inside of us everywhere we go. Let's be honest. I want it to sink in. You carry Him. He's in you. You know, Jesus doesn't give a piece of Himself to one person and a piece to somebody else. You know, everything He is in you. If you're born again. The Bible calls us believers. It does not call us understanders. Hallelujah. You know. Glory to God. You know, when the Father looks at you, we know this, He sees Jesus. We've heard that forever. And God the Father loves you as much as He loves Jesus. Oh, yes, glory, we know that. Do we really know that? John 17, 23. I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me, and I have loved them as you have loved me. While our spirit is absolutely awesome right now, our minds need a little work on them. To the Corinthians, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 2:16, "For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." Your brain can't handle that, but your spirit knows it's true, because your spirit understands what your brain cannot figure out. The mind of Christ has perfect wisdom, but our natural mind doesn't have perfect wisdom. That's why James wrote in James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Now, it's right to ask for wisdom. And if you want to know, you need to ask about it. But when asking for the mind of Christ, when you have it, it's one of those things, it's on deposit. We need to draw from what we have. Amen. The purpose of a renewed mind is to set the boundaries for God's kind of thinking. In other words, you don't have to guess. We don't have to wonder how the Lord thinks and what he wants. You got a Bible.
Amen.
It's in his word. The carnal minds we're born with gets us into trouble. Y'all do know that, don't you? Romans 8:7. Because the carnal mind is enmity, a hostile against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. The carnal mind, or the physical mind, the mind, is prideful, stubborn, self-centered. It is easily given to anger, it's impatient, while self-righteously calling it righteous indignation. The carnal mind is touchy, overly sensitive, resentful when reproved, jealous, unteachable, and regards itself far more important than it ought to. Jesus was the total opposite of what I just described. He was humble, obedient, focused on others, patient, forgiving, a servant because he had a perfect mind. And the word says, he has given that mind to you and to me. Do you want to know his mind? Or look how he lived. Then you know his mind. Church, every word we speak and action we perform begins in the mind.
Amen.
Proverbs 23:7 says, as a man thinks in his heart, that's what that man is. So however you're thinking, that's how you're going to end up being. Hebrews 12:2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. What was he thinking? About you? About me? The most horrendous and unspeakable distress any man could face, the mind of Christ at that time, the mind of Christ went the full distance.
Amen.
Because he had you and me on his mind.
Amen.
Do you understand that he was thinking of all mankind?
Amen.
Those who have accepted him and those who have not?
Amen.
Through the ages. We're talking about God here. We're not talking about your neighbor.
Yes.
The Son of God, whose mind was able to focus in on why he came, doing what his Father wanted him to do, he volunteered. And in that climb and in that distance, anyone who had ever lived up to that point and anyone who has ever lived after that point was flashing through his mind that he was paying a price for everyone to really continue what we would call living, but for the first time in their life to really live. He was making a life for them when they had none. See, it is thinking the way Jesus thinks that will enable us to develop the eternal mindset to walk in obedience, to set your mind on things above, not on things on this earth. Get your mind off of everything on this earth. Get your mind on what's happening up there. If ever there was a time to get your mind on things of heaven, it is now. Don't be set on this earth. Rethink where you're going and what you're doing.
Yes.
Time is too short. Your world's going to change in a moment. In a moment.
The fate of America is in the hands of the church. Will we wake up and rise to the occasion? A Pocket of Time is an end-time 3-CD series supernaturally given to Sandra as a word for today. These teachings will help you know how to pray, how to take your stand, and will open your eyes to what's happening in America and around the world. The day is short and the opportunity is fading, so order A Pocket of Time by calling or by going to our website.
At the present time, the enemy is targeting the thought life of the church. And it's a major assault, but that's nothing new. He's always done that. The great King Solomon was visited by every other king on the earth. They came to learn his wisdom. That's pretty amazing. But get this, Solomon was not satisfied. Is anybody listening? We've got so many dissatisfied people sitting in the church. We want something else. That's what Solomon did. Solomon wasn't satisfied with what God gave him. He wasn't satisfied that every king on the earth came to see him. So he married the daughters of those same kings in order to increase favor with those kings. Well, how strange is that? He supposed that if their daughters were his wife, these other kings would not attack him. They weren't trying to attack him. His mind kicked in. He lost his own wisdom. But, listen to me. Solomon was trying to create favor with man when he already had the favor of God. Church, we have the favor of God. When you try to create in the flesh more of what God has already given you, you defile his gift. You insult the favor of God that's on your life. It shows a lack of appreciation for what God has done in your life. And you would choose man's favor and man's opinion above God's. That's what it says. Before Solomon, Adam and Eve did the same thing. The deceiver said to Eve, "You'll be like God if you do this." Well, she already was. She already was like God.
That's right.
So are we.
Amen.
The deceiver's goal was to make Eve want more than what God had already given to her and to Adam. We've spoken often about tearing down strongholds, but do we really understand what we're saying? Strongholds live in the mind, we know that. They're those things or thoughts that people trust in rather than trust in God. That's a stronghold. Anything you trust in more than you trust God. And it lodges in your mind that your mind goes there. The most trustworthy person in the universe is worthy of our trust. That's Jesus. And it's robbery to trust anyone or anything more than we trust the Lord.
Amen.
When we put our trust elsewhere, we build a stronghold that becomes the hiding place for the devil's work to steal, kill, and destroy. Much of the time, we don't even realize what we've done. Example, one negative thought does not create a stronghold. This is time to say, glory to God, thank you, Jesus, amen. But a series of undisciplined negative thoughts create a stronghold. Each of those thoughts being like a brick building, meaning a wall of negativity that literally is being built in your mind. And you're building that wall higher and higher. And higher. The devil does not know your thoughts. Get that straight, because that question has been asked many times. The devil does not know your thoughts, but, big but, He does know what thoughts he has whispered in your mind. He watches to see if you accept those thoughts and if you will entertain those thoughts. Here's the truth. For any problem, any question, any need that you or I have, the answer is in Jesus, and Jesus is in you. That's the truth. And not only is he in you, he's always ready to lead you, guide you, direct you, answer you, so that you are guided by the mind of Christ instead of your own limited thinking. He gives you a guideline in Philippians 4. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And always talk to God about what you're trying to do here. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Glory to God. A powerful way to grow in the mind of Christ is to pray in the Spirit. When we pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit prays those things that we don't have a clue about how to pray. In the process, we unlock the mind of Christ to release the insights, the answers, the revelations that we need to walk as powerful disciples. Would you like to know what your spirit's praying? The Bible says to ask. One of the ways you can is to ask the Lord for the interpretation of your prayers, that you pray in the Spirit. We're exhorted to pray for the interpretation, 1 Corinthians 14:13. It's by the interpretation of tongues that your brain gets to find out what your spirit was praying. And the Bible says ask. If you've never asked the Lord to let you know what you're praying for in the Spirit, I'm going to encourage you to do so. And then I'm going to encourage all of us to say right here, Lord, please forgive us for not doing what you told us to do. We all need to have more insight. Please forgive us. Please forgive us. But when you do, be quiet and listen. Expect an answer. God may surprise you with insight or an answer you never would have dreamed of in 100 years. One thing is sure. We don't learn to function from the mind of Christ without the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God is a spirit. He looks at you as a spirit. And what he sees is Jesus in you. God the Father, that's what he sees. 1 John 4. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Jesus never had a pity party. You've never been to one of his pity parties. He never had one. He was never pitiful. And he was never, ever controlled by his feelings. Ever. I'm talking about the Jesus that lives inside of you. Amen. That Jesus. Church, living by the mind of Christ is not something we fight for. It's something we enter into. Amen. By exchanging our carnal mind, natural mind, for the mind of Christ. It's a choice we make. Amen. It's a commitment we hold on to. Ephesians 1:3 says it. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. You have them. Has blessed. Already done. Oh, this is so precious. Before God created Adam and Eve, he first created everything they would ever need. Everything was prepared ahead of time. Now, maybe this isn't going to matter to you, but Lord, it did to me. In the very same way, before you were ever born, God had created everything you will ever need, including every spiritual blessing. And I wrote over here on the side, I've got everything. He created everything. He got it all for me. He gave me every spiritual blessing. He says, let her go. She's ready. Send her on down. Hallelujah. Yeah. She lacks nothing. Amen. Faith is knowing that God has already provided everything you will ever need. It's all on deposit inside your spirit. Somebody needs to go to the bank of your spirit and draw some things out. It's already there. Believe that because His Word says we have the mind of Christ, believe you got it. Believe what He says about you. It's what your God is saying to you. Embrace what God says by faith. Knowing that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, make that yours. The Lord said through Jeremiah, an interesting scripture, Jeremiah 17, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river and will not fear when heat comes, but its leaf will be green and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. Now let me say something about that scripture. Our rewards have a direct link to the activity in your mind. I search the heart. In other words, I evaluate your thinking. That'll help you understand it. I evaluate your thinking. When he says, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways. How you think will produce the fruit and the behavior, whether good or bad. So the Lord is evaluating your thinking. Why don't we make room and allow for this mind to be in you, which was in Christ Jesus? I close with this precious promise, Isaiah 26. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Isaiah 26:3. And we've already learned that in order to really grow in the mind of Christ and to receive things in the mind of Christ, it starts with wanting it. Wanting and believing you got what you have. Yeah. Believing that God has already given you everything you need. So that in these end days with that last scripture, anything that comes around, he's going to give us a peace to handle what comes our way.